Let's go.
What are you doing? Well, I see you're here. Well, we've had several rehearsals. Have you come to any of them?
No, I didn't.
I don't have any tambourine music. Do you guys have any tambourine? Okay, listen. You can play, but only when I point to you. You got it? Now give Heather back her seat. That's her seat. You gonna sit? You gonna sit on this side?
Should I stay in my place?
Now don't play until I tell you to.
Okay.
Okay. Got it?
I'll play.
For you.
Detective Stan Stone, what are you doing here?
Well, I'm missing something. I'm investigating stuff. Somebody stole, well, I'm not saying stole because we're in a church and all, but somebody, I had a bunch of snowballs and they're missing. I did see Pastor Jordan kind of, eyeing them earlier, but I don't know. What are you doing here?
But Detective Sandstone, this is our Christmas program.
That's next week. Next week is Christmas. Well, y'all look pretty, though.
Detective Sandstone, yes. Turn around.
Turn around? Oh! Hi, Pastor. There's Pastor Jordan. Pastor Jimmy, how you doing? You know, he kind of reminds me of the prophet Elisha. He hasn't been talking about bears to y'all, has he? No? Mm. No? Okay, just checking.
I told you we were doing our Christmas program.
You're doing your Christmas program? What song are you doing? Is it that one song, that one that you get your groove on?
Yep, that's the one.
That's the one? Oh, do you think I could do it with you?
I don't know. What do you think, Miss Lori?
Please.
If he gets in the back, maybe.
All right. Cool. Thank you. All right. Are you ready? Are you ready? Okay. This okay? Hit it!
And while they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. And she wrapped him in cloth and laid him in the manger because there's no room for them in the inn. God has this messy plan, a plan to save the world. And to do that, he was going to send a son. Where does the God of the universe send his son? Where does the King of Kings and Lord of Lords come? To a barn, a stable, a manger, of all places. Certainly no place fit for a king. But then again, this wasn't any ordinary king. When I say it was messy, I mean it was messy. It was a barn, a stable, So you've got animals and animal stuff, manure and mud. A pitiful place for people, much less the King of Kings to be born. Why would God do that? Well, I can't tell you that exactly, because the prophet Isaiah tells us that his thoughts are not our thoughts, and his ways are not our ways. But that same prophet 400 years before said, "All we like sheep have gone astray, each of us to our own ways, and that the Lord has laid our iniquities on him." You see, Jesus came to a messy place. A barn, well, yes, that's messy, but he came to a messy world. Why? Because the shepherd was coming to take care of his sheep and to prepare a way for his sheep to go home. That's what a shepherd does. He lives where the sheep are, he sleeps where they sleep, and he eats where they eat. That got Jesus in trouble. Why did Jesus eat with the sinners? Because that's what a shepherd does. An angel appeared to the shepherds in the field and said, "This will be a sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in cloth lying in a manger." A sign. Do you ever wonder what that sign was? A sign for what? Maybe it was a sign that Jesus can be accessible to everyone. A sign that the God who owns the cattle on 1,000 hills can relate to a homeless person. Because Jesus never had a home. He never had a place to rest his head. Maybe it was a sign that Jesus would have nothing to do with the social status of mankind. A sign that he detests the splendor of humans because it was not worthy of him. But it was a sign for us that we should follow suit. In fact, the Apostle Paul would later write that we should have the same attitude as Jesus Christ, being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, being a servant, being made in human likeness. You see, being a servant is messy, and Jesus set this incredible example. I mean, he got down on his knees and washed feet. The God of the universe, the God that deserves the best of everything, got down on his knees. He is the God who came to the world in a manger, a feed trough, of all places. Why such a messy place? Because he was following a messy plan. So needless to say, that very first Christmas was dirty. It was grimy, it was filthy, but thank God it was, because without it, what a mess we'd be in.
Stars are brightly shining. It is the night of the dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining till he appeared. The soul felt its worth, a thrill of hope
us to love one another. His law is love, and his gospel is peace. Chains shall he break, for the slave is a brother, and in his name all oppression shall cease. Sweet hymns of joy in grateful chorus raise we.
Emmanuel has that all the darkness could never overcome. Glory to God.
In Luke, we learn that Jesus' birth was late in the evening. It was either after sunset or it was at night, because when the shepherds were out at night, they were in the fields. And then suddenly, an angel appears, and he says, suddenly, this night. So since suddenly, this day, then they told Christ was born this day. And since, this day means that all the other Jewish days were there too. The Jewish days, then after that, the Messiah, he was born. We don't know exactly the day or the night, but we do celebrate Jesus' birth on December 25th. What kind of night, you might ask, when Jesus was born? Was it at night watch? Was it at the time when darkness was the most intense? The one thing we do know for sure is that his timing was no accident. His timing is always perfect. Jesus said in 1 John that I am the light of the world. He said, in John, we also learn that he says that he came because he was the true light that will overcome the world. John 1 and 5 also says that he is the light that shines in the darkness. Jesus also explains, goes on and says that everyone who believes in me might not remain in darkness. And you'll find that also in John 12, 46. Christmas is also the time of tremendous hope and what hope we need. We need our hope in him. The light has come, for Jesus is our light. He is the illuminator. He is the beacon of light. In desperate times that we live in today, he is the darkness that will never prevail. He will shine lighter, and he will overcome it. Not in the past, not now, not ever will his light ever be diminished. Jesus was born at night to bring light into our troubled world. His light is the powerful. It is so powerful that it will outshine everything else. The night that Jesus was born, he came to give us three gifts. The first gift that he gives us is his love. His love is profound, it is intense, and it is divine love. It is the agape love. It is unconditional. We can never be separated from it. The almighty creator of this universe, he set aside and he became human so that he may come for you, for me, and for this world to bring us salvation. For this is how God loved the world. He gave his only begotten son, that whoever may believe on him may have everlasting life. And that is in John 3:16. The night Jesus was born, his second gift he gave us was peace. Peace, oh peace, how we search for peace. His peace is nothing that this world can give us. His peace is supernatural, it's never ending, and it's the perfect peace. That night in Bethlehem, when the shepherds watched over their flock, and then suddenly an angel was joined by a vast of others, and they were dancing around, praising him, the armies of heaven, saying, glory to God in the highest, highest to heaven and on earth, and peace to those who know God is well pleased. Luke 2, 13 and 4. The night Jesus was born, the third gift that he gave us was joy. Inexpressible, overwhelming, genuine joy. An angel announced to the shepherd, do not be afraid. He said, I bring you the news that will bring great joy to all people. Luke 2:10. And oh, what a night that our Jesus, our Savior, was born.
There are only 12 verses that tell us the story about the wise men and the star. This is what the Bible says. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was greatly disturbed, and all of Jerusalem with him. And he called together all the chief priests and teachers of the law, and he asked them where the Christ was to be born. "In Bethlehem, in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written." One Old Testament prophecy in Numbers 24:17 says, "A star shall come out of Jacob, and a scepter rise out of Israel." But what was the star? Was it a comet, a supernova, or a planetary alignment? These are the most common explanations given. Well, today with computer programs, this charting of the stars can be done with great accuracy. And a documentary called In the Star of Bethlehem, in that documentary, Friedrich Larsen concludes that the king planet Jupiter, aligned with the king planet Jupiter, crowned a new moon Regulus at the feet of Virgo the Virgin, and then that later appeared to intersect with the planet Venus. This all took place within the constellation of Leo the Lion, symbolizing the tribe of Judah. Now, the stacking of the planet Jupiter and Venus would have created a brilliant light that it eventually appeared appeared in the sky over Bethlehem. And this seemed to be the most naturalistic explanation for the star. Ultimately, what matters most is not what the star was, but to whom it led the Magi. And in Scripture, it's only mentioned as a sign of his birth and a guide to the Christ child. And could it be that the brilliant light was also symbolic of what Jesus' purpose was to come? For Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." The wise men are often called the three kings. But in the Bible, we're never told that they were actually three or that they were even kings. They became three because of the three gifts that they brought Jesus: gold, frankincense, and myrrh. They had seen an unusual star in the sky. They knew it stood for something special, a king of Israel, and so it was significant enough for them to make that trip and travel to see him. The star must have first appeared over Bethlehem while the Magi were still in the east. But from that distance, they would not have been able to tell that it was over Bethlehem. So when they made their trip, they came to Jerusalem, the capital city, which would be a logical place to begin to look for the new king of the Jews. It seems that the star must have disappeared by the time they arrived there, because they had to go to Jerusalem and ask King Herod where the king of the Jews was to be born. So at that time, the star must have not been guiding them. Second of all, they rejoiced when they saw the star again as they traveled towards Bethlehem, about a 6-mile journey. After the Magi had met with King Herod, the star led them to Bethlehem and stood over the location of Jesus. Now, contrary to what is often thought, the star didn't lead them there, and they didn't show up on the day that Christ was born. It was sometime later. Because they found Jesus in a house, and they found Jesus and his parents there. It seems that the star led them to an exact house, an exact location, not just the city. For the Magi already knew they were in, that Jesus was in Bethlehem. This is what Herod had told them, and this is what he had learned from the priest and the scribes. Before a normal star, it would be impossible to know which house was directly underneath it. So there may have been some type of visual effect or some type of manifestation of God's power that led them to the exact location where Jesus was. The time of his visit could have been nearly 2 years after Jesus was born, because we hear that Herod, afraid that his position as king was threatened, tried to eliminate Jesus by taking out all of the male children in Bethlehem under the age of 2. Well, whatever the mechanism was that God used that day, the fact that the star led the Magi to Christ is evidence that it was uniquely designed and made by God for a very special purpose. God can use extraordinary means for extraordinary purposes. And surely, the birth of Jesus was extraordinary and worthy of honor in the heavens. As Psalms 19:1 declares, "The heavens declare the glory of God, and the skies proclaim the work of his hands."
to save the world. Wondrous gift of heaven, the Father sends the Son. Plan from time eternal, moved by
ever wondered how did Mary become pregnant with the Son of the Almighty God? I mean, do you think Satan somehow found out about God's plan to redeem those that he loved and he tried to stop it? Can you imagine the battles that must have taken place between the angels and demons as they tried to stop the angel Gabriel from making it to Mary to explain to her that she had been chosen above all others to be the mother of the Son of the Almighty God? See, my mind, it goes to the many different things. The things that could have happened while Mary was well pregnant with the Son of the Almighty God in her womb as they traveled towards Bethlehem. See, Satan and his demons, they could have transformed themselves into many different characters to try to cause harm. Can you see the myriads of angels encompassed all around about them, protecting them every step of the way from all harm, keeping them safe? Then came the birth of the child who would be called Jesus. Emmanuel, Wonderful Counselor, Almighty God, Prince of Peace. See, when he was born, he already was. All of God is in this tiny infant. Light, it encircles his face and radiated from his tiny hands. Can you see the angels all gazing down at him? See, they knew him in heaven, but now they're looking at him reborn as a human, as a tiny infant. Perhaps they're looking at his hands, these hands that would one day be pierced. See, I'm sure the angels probably thought that they were there to protect Jesus. But when would it be that they would find out that they would not be allowed to save him from the beatings that he would take for our sins? How would these angelic beings, how would they be silent? The Son of God is suffering. The shepherds were there too. Can you see the shepherds gazing down at this beautiful baby boy? They would see him wrapped in swaddling cloths, and they would know in the back of their mind that's the strips of cloth that we use to wrap the baby lamb's legs to strengthen them. Do you think for one second, perhaps, when they looked at this child, that they seen the true Lamb of God who would one day be sacrificed for all mankind? See, when he was born, He already was. See, he who is ageless is now moments old. He who strode upon the stars now has legs too weak to walk. The hands that held back the oceans are now tiny infants' fists. Do you think that Mary really understood, really comprehended who she held in her arms, that she held the author of grace? See, he who had never asked a question, Mary would give him answers. The source of language himself would learn words from Mary. He who had never stumbled, Mary would carry. He who had never hungered, Mary would feed. The King of all creation is who Mary held in her arms. When he was born, he already existed. He just reclothed himself to look like us. He vacated himself and he came here on a mission. Listen to the words of the Apostle Paul in Philippians 2, 6 to 11. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges and he took the humble position of a slave. And he was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and he died a criminal's death on a cross. Therefore, aren't we glad that there is a therefore? Because God, he elevated him to the place of highest honor and he gave him a name that is far above all other names, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue shall proclaim that Jesus Christ, he is Lord, to glory of God the Father.
Unto us from on high, reaching down into the deepest night, to the world hope has come in the dark. The light of light has dawned. What a mystery, oh wonder. Oh, how can it be that heaven has come to us? Unto us, meek and mild, God eternal, born a helpless child. Aside heaven's throne, filled in weakness, came unto his own. What a mystery, oh wonder. Oh, how can it be that heaven has come to us? Unto us grace has come, here to seek and bring the sinner home. Live to die rose to reign. Son of man, the lamb for sinners slain. What a mystery, oh, I love. Oh, how can it be that heaven has come? What a mystery, oh, I love. Oh, how can it be that heaven has come to us? Heaven has come to us.
A child has been given to us. God Almighty has given his own son to us. He will be charged with leading the people. He will be wounded for the wrongs we did, crushed for the evil we did. The punishment that makes us well will be given to him. And we are healed because of the stripes that he bore upon his own body. So this Christmas, when you are tired and you're weary and you think there is no way out, do not lose heart. Do not give up. For this child that was born in a manger, he is no longer a child. He is our risen Savior. He is our risen King. And he is not just a king. He is the King of all kings. So now I can take everything to him. Every anxiety, every fear, every sorrow, every pain. My whole life I lay down at the feet of King Jesus. Just take me to the King.
Take me to the King. I don't have much to bring. My heart is torn in pieces. It's my offering. Take me to the King.
Truth is, I'm tired. Options are few. I'm trying to pray, but where are you? I'm all churched out, hurt and abused. I can't fake what's left to do.
Come on.
Truth is, I'm weak. No strength to fight, no tears to cry. Even if I tried, but still my soul refuses to die. Mm-hmm. One touch will change my life. Take me to people's pain.
Can we just praise him? One night, one star. Baby, boy, the end of this. Take me to the King. Take me to the King. The star had great significance. That night, great significance. The baby. Take me to the King. We drive by places and they have nativity scenes, and that's all great and fine. And people in their head, they still got Jesus as a little bitty baby in the manger. He was, but he's not now. He's all grown up. He went to the cross and he died. He was buried in a borrowed tomb. But on the third day, he rose again. Not only did he rise again, but he ascended. We can talk about take me to the King, but can I tell you, one day the King is coming after. The King is coming after us. Wouldn't it be something if it was a morning, something like this here, and all of a sudden while you and I are standing here thinking about celebrating Christmas and the play that we just had, and all of a sudden we heard a shout. The Bible said that it's going to be so loud that the dead are going to rise first. Then you and I who are alive and remain are going to be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, and we're going to meet him in the air. Take me to the King. Take me to the King. I think about a lot of people and what a privilege it would be to meet them and maybe shake their hand and even have a conversation with them. But can I tell you this morning, all of those people pale in comparison with, take me to the King. Take me to the one who paid my sin debt. Take me to the one who inscribed my name in the Lamb's Book of Life. Take me to the one who's going to call my name out. Take me to the one who's built a city that I can reside in. Take me to the King. And I wonder this morning as we kind of wrap this service up, I wonder how many of us are ready to go see the King. You're not going to be able to go see the King just because you was at a Christmas program. You're not going to go see the King just because you're a good person. You're not even going to be able to go to see the King just because you've got a Bible and you read it. The only way you're going to go see the King is if you've bowed down and gave your life to him completely. It's the only way. Boy, leading up to today, a lot of us, we've had a very hectic, busy few days. Gayla and I, in the last 2 days, have been to 4 different funerals. From some that you knew beyond any shadow of a doubt where they were at, to others that there was a lot of doubt and wonder. This morning, I don't want to take for granted that you're ready, because you may not be. You may be a good person, but if the King summons you, are you ready to go be with him? I want you to bow your heads for just a moment, if you will. Father, God, we come to this part of this program. God, it's our desire to go to see the King. God, what a presentation. God, from beginning to end, what a presentation. God, how it was wrapped up with, take me to the King. I want to see him. Father, I pray today, I pray for every person, young and old. God, if they're not ready, because we don't know the day or the hour that you're going to call us, Lord. But God, I pray that today, I pray that there be decisions that would be made in preparation to go see the King. Lord, your word said we're all going to see you. We're just not all going to stay with you. There's going to be some that are going to hear these words, well done, thy good and faithful servant. There's going to be others that are going to hear those horrible, horrible words that will last throughout eternity. I'm sorry, but I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of iniquity. God, I just pray that today, I pray that as we've tried to present you on this Christmas program, God, I pray that the Holy Spirit has dealt with people's hearts. God, if they're not right with you, I pray that today they make it right with you. God, you've made it so simple. You said that if we would call upon the name of the Lord, we would be saved. If we call upon you and ask you to forgive us, you said you would in no way cast us aside, but you would forgive us. God, I'm asking right now, God, if there's hearts in this room today that are not where they need to be with you, Holy Spirit, would you deal with them right now? Your heads are bowed, your eyes are closed. I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm not going to try to make you do something that you're not comfortable with doing. I just want you to bow your heads and close your eyes for a moment. I want to ask you a very personal question today. If the king were to summons you, would you be ready to meet him? Has your sins been put under the blood of Christ, and are you ready to meet him? I want you to think about that for just a moment, because a lot of times at church, we just think because we're at church, everything's okay. Think about it for just a moment. If the king summons you, not because you're good, not because you're even a church-going person, the only way you can go is through the blood of Christ and be born again. You say, Pastor, I know that not a doubt in my mind that if I were to die right now, heaven would be my home. No questions asked. I know that. If you can say that with all assurance, with your head bowed and your eyes closed, I don't want anybody looking around. If you can say that with all assurance, would you just slip your hand up toward heaven right now as a testimony? I know that my sins have been forgiven. I know that I'm right with God. There's no question in my mind. I know all of my sins are gone. Now, would you put your hands down? All over this room, there was people, for whatever reason, never lifted their hand. My Bible said this, if you're ashamed of me, I'm going to be ashamed of you. And today, the greatest gift that you could ever receive is not found underneath a tree. It's found in Jesus Christ. And I'm going to ask us all this morning. A lot of people didn't lift their hand. And I'm going to ask us all this morning to pray this prayer. Now listen, if all you do is pray the prayer, and you don't do anything about changing your life and changing your lifestyle, it was a wasted prayer for you. But if you say, I want to be changed this morning, I want Jesus to forgive me, I want him to come into my life, and I want my life to be changed, and when the king summons me, I want to be ready, and I want to hear him say, well done, thy good and faithful servant. Enter on into the joys of heaven. I want to hear that. If that's you this morning, and I want to ask every one of us to pray this prayer together, and pray it out loud, and we're going to pray it together. Are you ready? Say, dear God, I'm a sinner. I need a Savior. What I've saw today tells me Jesus is the Savior. I accept him into my life. Forgive me, Lord. Cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Write my name in your book of life. I want to be ready when you call me. In Jesus' name, amen. Can we give him praise this morning? Come on, can we give him praise this morning? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Now, a lot of question is this. You mean that's it? Absolutely. He paid the price. Now, that was free. Now comes the hard part. You got to change. You got to do your part in this. He forgave you. Don't beat yourself up no more. He has forgiven you. He said there was rejoicing in heaven over just one. Can I tell you, I don't know how many that didn't lift their hands prayed that minute, but can I tell you, if there was only one, can I tell you, heaven right now is a noisy, noisy place. How many will watch this on video maybe next week or next year or and have a life-changing experience because of the King, because of the King. Can we let all of those who participated this morning, can we let them know how glad we are for them and how we appreciate? Let me just say this, and we're going to pray and dismiss. I just want to say a really, really, really big, special, special thank you to Miss Gayla for putting everything together. I know she has a lot of help and a lot of people do. She comes up with these ideas and then kind of throws them out, and then they... And then what you saw this morning all comes together. Here's what I like to do. I don't watch them practice. I want to see it for the very first time. I want to see it for the very first time. Now, I've heard all the songs about, I don't know, 7 or 8 million times, you know, because this didn't start like last week. This started like, I don't know, February or something like that. We start going through this thing. Can I tell you, I am amazed every year it gets better. It gets more powerful than what it was the year before. Everybody, man, from the little guys all the way up, wasn't it incredible? And I'm going to tell you, the last song. Wow, that just put a bow on this thing. That put a bow on it for me. It's incredible, incredible, incredible. Hey, thanks for being here. Don't forget, Wednesday night we're going to have regular service, but don't forget next Sunday, come for 1 hour, thereabouts, 1 hour. We're going to have communion, and we're going to do Christmas the way it ought to be. I'm going to ask Brother Mark if he will pray our dismissal prayer, give Gayla and I time to get to the back.
Father, Lord, we just thank you, Lord, for this day. God, we thank you for this season. God, we ask you just be with us as we go our separate ways today. Lord, I just ask God you just... continue, Lord, to just touch us and bless us, Lord. We give you praise and glory and honor in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen.